So we have been discussing Chatushloki, the four most important verses of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Today we were entering in the third one. But simultaneously, as we are a big community and we have so many priorities and necessities, so many other subjects are also joining in with Varshanaton Oida therapy. The Vinda family. As a matter of fact, in these days, I have a maturing concept of how the Vinda family will run when I'm not here anymore. So I've been working on that, thinking about it for the last 30 years. But now it's maturing. It's coming to clarity. What we want, so that we will have many expansions of the Vinda family without anybody screwing the other's life. Which is a difficult thing, because in administrations you find that often, that some one person screws the other lives for some stupid reasons, little envy and so, whatever. But we want to settle things in such a way that happiness will be sustained in the endeavor of creating more and more places of spiritual love for many souls. That's my basic concept. And I know that will not be working perfectly always, obviously, but at least it will not grind to a halt, because there'll be so much freedom according to the sweet blessings of our Guru Devas, so much freedom that those who are capable and inspired will be able to do it. Nobody's going to tell them, hey, you're not supposed to do this. Because we are all supposed to do it. Now that's what we are here for. Why you become a father when you start your own family and have your own children? Why? Because that's the nature. Nature makes you a father. Nature makes you a guru. Father and mother is guru. You can't help it. You say, oh, it's too much, yeah? Tell that to your kids. You are too much for me. It doesn't make sense, no? So, wanting, not wanting, able or not able, just do it and qualify it. Do it and qualify. Then the blessings will come to you. And if correction is not needed, correction will also come to you, because that's the way life runs. So this is yesterday's Bhagavatam Shloka. Everything which is not in connection with the Absolute Truth is just illusion. So that was the second verse of the Chatushloki. I need a bigger paper. Where's my big paper for this? We have no, we didn't bring any. Anybody knows, Lalita Madhava, we have big papers. We just bring the board, but not the paper. Well, maybe we can invent something. No.
That's Steffi bringt gleich großes Papier.
Ja, gut. Komm, coming. So, Chatushloki is the running principle of our life. The running principle of our life is searching for the truth, serving the truth, bringing the truth into our life to such a degree that we will actually be accepted as sincere servants of the truth. I mean, this is a minimal requirement, no? Or do you want to stay, make the statement, I'm the servant of illusion. I'm a servant of my ego. I don't want to know anything else from anybody else because I'm pretty happy the way it's running for me. That makes you an asocial entity. And we are exactly, we should be the opposite. We should be somebody who is part of the universal harmony. And we should be somebody of the willingness to achieve the highest goal in our community efforts. Willing to do the maximum to achieve the highest goal in our spiritual community and in our personal efforts, of course, as well. So this is a very interesting proposal. Not proposal, it's a very interesting requirement. It is a requirement of a doctor to try his level best to save your life. Unfortunately, our doctors are a big failure. Our medical system is a big failure. That's why I started an organization, Conscious Medics. It's a big organization, very important. We have many big scientists working in it. Conscious Medics. But most of all, they don't know what's going on in the Novinda family because it's very many multi-branched. What to do? Well, such melas can help. Anyhow, the Conscious Medics, they are recognizing that our medical system is a hoax because you go to medicine school for 6 years and in those 6 years you get 2 or 3 hours of nutrition teachings. When the Hippocrates rule was, let your food be your medicine, they don't take that into consideration. Let your pill be your medicine, is their concept. So that's why their system is corrupted. So when I say that we have a duty to achieve the maximum perfection in our ability of anything we do, that's our human life commitment. And whether we like it or we don't like it, it's a reality. It's not that Paramadvaita decided that. No. Life is the teacher. The underlying, the original law, the original spirit of life is giving us a dictation. And that dictation is, get your show together to the maximum degree. Not according to German law, and not according to the United Nations law. We are supposed to get our show together according to the divine law. That's the criteria. That is the highest. And by Guru Shastra Sadhu, we are fortunate to have an access to the divine law. This is our faith. This is our, by the Bhagavatam, we have access to the divine law. Can you imagine that? That's what we believe. And that's what's been proven. By what? By the Chatusloki. The Lord says, I was there in the beginning, I'm there in the middle, and in the end it's only me who is there. It means all the other ego efforts vanished. Bill Gates vanished. Madonna vanished. Maradona vanished. All the big thieves in the world vanished. All the great artists in the world vanished. All the beauty queens vanished. But Krishna not vanished. He was there in the beginning and he's there in the end. And you're part of him. So you have to relate to him and not to the illusion. Wake up. You don't have to relate to the competition and the status quos and all that. You can. You can always dress in the morning. How will people look at me? From the front? You can always think what the world is thinking about you, but that's not carrying any importance. It's what Krishna thinks about you. That's an important thing. So, we are in this illusion world. We are competing in this illusion world. We are practicing many injustices in this illusion world. And we are getting the karma in this illusion world, both good karma and bad karma. So, that's the rule. Now, Krishna says, wait, my friend, in the end, I'll be there for you. Now, I am there for you. In the beginning, I was there for you. Even your dear wife is not that way. She may be the most important person in your life, but she wasn't there before you. She's not there inside of everything, and she won't be there at the end. So, neither your beloved children. As a matter of fact, you were there before them, but actually you are all eternal souls, so the children, well, important issue, children, no? My God, no? I mean, why we talk about guru-disciple? We just can talk about parents and children. It's the same topic. It carries the same weight. It has the same love principle to make it work. And it has the same dependence on the higher laws. Because the guru and the disciple is not independent from the divine laws, and the parents and their children are not independent from the divine laws. So therefore, we are all in the same boat. Congratulations, my dear fathers, and especially mothers, because you're spiritual masters. You have all the weight on your shoulders. There she is, Gauramrita. There is Bhakti Shakti, Kupal Bhakti, and the fathers, of course, we will not ignore, please, no? We give full recognition to the fathers also. But mother gets the first choice, I don't know why. For some reason she gets the first one to lean on to. So, Krishna says, I was there before, I'm in the middle and in the end, and he's there as the super soul, always guiding us. So we are all spiritual masters by default. By default, what is the default? Well, procreation is the default. As soon as a child is procreated, you are a spiritual master. Whether you like it or not. Vandana, she has so many disciples. Mother Vilasini, she has so many disciples. Mother Yamuna, she has so many disciples. Mother Shyama also has a few disciples. So here, Prem Sita also has disciples. So, and they depend on everything from the teacher. Because what the children will receive from the parents is the heartfelt effort for perfection by the parents. Now sometimes we ignore it. I mean, I had to leave my house. I had to leave my house, my father and mother, even though I had a very, very, very loving mother. But she couldn't give me the answers I needed about the infinite. I had to leave that house and find my guru who was going to give me the answers I needed to do my life, to do who I have to be in my life. that did not separate me from my father and mother at all. I tried to preach to my father for 30 years. I tried to reach him. That was tough. But Arjuna, you know that big guy who went running with a beard here, he reached my father when he was that size. When he was a small little guy. He preached to my father and my father was defeated. It's true. And then Sadhu Maharaj also gave him a little kick over, and my father was, from hate towards devotees to full appreciation of devotees. It's a big, big, big jump happened, thanks to Arjuna. So, and thanks to Sadhu Maharaj. So, I had to leave my home to find my guru. And then, with my guru, I could help my parents. And my brother and sister as well. I tried. We try. Many of us have had our parents die with Krishna's name in their ear, by the grace of Prabhupada. Even some of the parents who have not been practicing devotees, but Krishna's name have come to their ear and heart just before they left. Anyhow, now we come to the third verse. Brahma, oh, now you give me the English, here's this. Brahma, O Brahma, please know that the universal elements enter into the cosmos and at the same time do not enter into the cosmos. Similarly, I myself also exist within everything created, and at the same time, I'm outside of everything. Srila Prabhupada explains, the great elements of material creation, namely earth, water, fire, air, and ether, all enter into the body of all manifested entities, your body. The seas, mountains, aquatics, plants, reptiles, birds, beasts, human beings, demigods, and everyone materially manifested. And at the same time, such elements are differently situated. I repeat that, that was a little confusing. The great elements of material creation, namely earth, water, fire, air, and ether, all enter into the body of all manifested entities. Into the seas, mountains, aquatics, plants, reptiles, birds, beasts, human beings, demigods, and everyone materially manifested. And at the same time, such elements are differently situated. In the developed stage of consciousness, a human being can study both physiological and physical science. But the basic principle of such sciences are nothing but the material elements and nothing more. The body of the human being and the body of the mountain, as also the body of the demigods, including Brahma, are all of the same ingredients, earth, water, etc. At the same time, the elements are beyond the body. The elements were created first, and therefore they entered into the bodily construction later. But in both circumstances, they entered the cosmos and also did not enter. Similarly, the Supreme Lord, by his different energies, namely the internal and external, is within everything in the manifested cosmos. I repeat, similarly, the Supreme Lord, by his different energies, namely the internal and external, is within everything in the manifested cosmos. At the same time, he's outside of everything, situated in the kingdom of God, Vaikuntha Loka, as described before. This is very nicely stated in the Brahma Samhita as follows. Ananda chinmaya rasa pratipavitavis tavir chaeva nitya rupataya kalavi goloka eva nivashati akilatma bhuto Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajam. I worship the personality of God at Govinda, who by expansion of his internal potency of transcendental existence, knowledge and bliss, enjoys in his own and expanded form. Simultaneously, he enters into every atom of the creation. My friends, what you just have heard, both the shloka and Prabhupada's commentary, it is just an unbelievable description of the infinite being visible partially and inaccessibly partially simultaneously. It is such a composition, I would compare it a symphony of the absolute. And to write this into words which are reasoning in the logic faculties, that is an accomplishment which only the knower of the truth can accomplish. The elements and the living beings, our being part of the original creator, entering into the physical dimension, being surrounded by the physical elements, but being of the nature of the Supreme Soul, then following our karmic sequences in this world until we die and go to the next stage. This flowing of the energies all through the creation, connected, interconnected through the highest control of the astronomical influence of the stars, as the readers or the ways to understand how the individual people are pursuing their paths, the whole thing is just too much. I mean, you have to recognize it's too much. Either the Vedas are the truths, they have to be given all the attention possible, or we are just little dreamers dreaming something which has no relevance whatsoever. Since our life is very important to us, obviously the second option is not there. We cannot be living in an illusion without any relevance to anything. So if life is relevant to us, this morning class is relevant to you, the Srimad Bhagavatam is relevant to you, then all the things you heard today from this symphony of the truth is extremely relevant, and it shows you that the infinite has an infinite ability. As the Lord goes into every atom, into every soul as a super soul, an infinite ability and an infinite meaning as well. That means you are also important. Don't be depressed. Sometimes people are depressed. They forget how important they are. In the eyes of your Creator, you are a queen and a king. I mean, I'm not trying to flatter you. I'm just trying to point out to you what is a child to his father and mother. When the mother of Krishna Kirtan sees her son, is she alive still? She feels, son. Not everybody feels like that, but she does. And the Creator also does. This is not an exaggeration. This is the reality. It doesn't matter whether you are 3 weeks old or you are 98. You are still the star. The the king, the most important queen of existence in the eyes of your creator, who is so unlimitedly powerful that he has created a potential of love for each and every one of us. There is not a more important one than the other. It's not that the big people with the money, they are the important people and the others are not. By the divine symphony of the infinite, even a little ant is part of that universal composition and greed, getting the same category of spirituality. Therefore, the spirit souls going karmically to so many different situations to learn that, to start appreciating each other. Like I may appreciate Halada for helping to organize this mela. And then somebody comes who, first time he's here with us, or hasn't done anything for the mela, except coming here, which is obviously very important. But shall I now think Halada is important, but that person is not important? Stupid. Huh? Cannot be like that. So if every individual comes here has the same value of the spiritual contents of his nature, then why exclude the ants? Why exclude the mouse? Why exclude anything or anybody? Why exclude the trees who make this place so beautiful? Why exclude the birds who are swimming in the lake? In the end of the day, I just want to say that you are top important. And your life is top important. And if others don't see that, if others have not recognized that, that is their short-sightedness. Not everybody can see everybody else, but that is their or your short-sightedness. Because in the infinite, before the Lord, each and every one of us is of the same incredible status of spiritual importance and a potential. So the wordings here are, he goes in, but he's not in. He's everywhere, but he's nowhere to be found. But these kind of words could make you feel like, hey, isn't that a very confusing statement? Isn't that very contradictory? And that's happening in the Vedas, even from Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate, from the first shloka of the Ishopanishad. Krishna reserves his right to appear contradictory and should not be ignored nevertheless. Do not put your silly little mind above the Lord. Don't do that. Don't think if he doesn't fit into my square, then he's out. That's what we are receiving as illusionary instructions by rational thinking, so-called science. A Goloka was telling me this morning, only believing what we see. With such a short-sighted, short-minded way, we cannot see our own position. We cannot even see our own value. That's why people commit suicide. They don't see a value in it. Think the test is too much. That's why people go to drugs. Because they think, but why trying to develop something higher? Just let's enjoy something lower. Huh? I mean, I can just take this pill. Now I feel far out. Maybe another pill? So people are obviously choosing lower things for having certain kinds of pleasant sensation because they haven't seen the value which they have as a pure guy, as a clear guy, as a clear lineage. They don't see it. So this option is always there to cheat yourself. But this is not what we can gain from the Bhagavatam. So Krishna reserves the right to contradict himself. The Ishopanishad is full of contradictions, and Krishna smiles. And I have a right to be like that. I'm in the beginning, I'm in the end, and you are nowhere. But you're part of me. Because in the heart of the infinite, each and every part and parcel is one and different of him. So that is what we are celebrating, the one and difference. And that is philosophically, my God. So a lot of things have been talked about that. We can go to Advaitavad, we can go to Shankaracharya, we can study how they spoke about one and difference. Shankaracharya is in himself the greatest contradiction because he taught Advaita and then he says Bhaja Govinda, Bhaja Govinda, Bhaja Govinda, Mudamate. My God, what the Shankaracharya, dear Guru, what do you want to tell me now? Don't waste your time with the grammar. Just come and worship Govinda. One time I was in a lecture of a Buddhist. He was a genius, a scientist. He spoke so eloquently about the universe and about its extensive influence and interactions that he was a good speaker too. You would almost fall in a kind of in a samadhic stage of, oh my God, this creation is too much. And then when he was just about to end his lecture, he said, and you know what's the most surprising? All this what I talked about comes from nothing. So when he ended the lecture, I walked up to him. It wasn't South Africa, I was Seventh Holland. I walked up to him and said, my dear scholar, you offend my feelings and intelligence with the ending words that all this comes from nothing. Then he smiled at me and looked and says, what makes you think that nothing means nothing? I mean nothing material. I say, okay, now I can go along with you. If you say it's nothing of the material thing, which is the cause of the infinite material manifestation, and that is as great or much greater than that creation, well, that's what we in bhakti embrace as the universal form, or we embrace as the infinite power of the one and difference in that incredible manifestation. So, I think the Srimad Bhagavatam is taking us to conclude. So the Shatrusloki is really, it compounds all the different amazingness of this contemplation into a conclusion, which is a conclusion that I belong to you. Oh my Lord, please let me be an instrument of your love. I just want to be with you and for you, and I want to make you happy because you have made me so happy. You have made me so happy that all the difficulties in my life becoming that small, and all the beauties I've received are unmeasurably great. So yes, there are some difficulties because we are difficult people. Because we are difficult complicated world we have created in our ego endeavors. But still, it's teeny. If I think of the Illimani, the sacred Apu in Bolivia, or the Zugspitze, which I haven't seen so closely like the Illimani. He's a god. He's an Apu. He's a sacred mountain. Or for us, more familiar, if I think of Govardhan, Krishna holding up the Govardhan, Krishna being the Govardhan, this is like surrealistic divinity coming into my emotional life as a little giri, which I worship. Look how many giris we have. We don't have only one. We have a whole altar full of giris. That means all of you, you go along with that. Yes, you also believe this. This incredible mountain is God. This incredible universe giving a statement on the divine. And what to speak of the sun, which we long so much to see in this Mela, but which just comes and goes, comes and goes, comes and goes, to play around with us, to tell us, I'm here, but you have to look for me. And when I'm there, everything becomes cozy and warm, and everybody wants to go out in the sun and see the sunshine come through the fog and the shining and reflecting on the lake and going to the trees. That's Krishna. Krishna is the sun. Krishna is Mother Earth also. Potential. Mother Earth is Krishna's potency expanded, his feminine potency, his huge mother ability, right there in front of us. So, but I hit my foot on a rock and I go, yeah, so what? I'm going to write a book about the rock in which I hit there. I'm going to make much out of that. We can understand the proper proportion of things by hearing the Srimad Bhagavatam Chaturshloki. This is the perfect magnifying glass for seeing the proper proportion of what's happening and what's not happening. What's the past, the present, and the future. All can be seen in there. Okay, that is how much I wanted to say about the Chaturshloki today.